go for another combatant, and not really the rumble, but at least Trundle will make Shen's life very difficult and push that side lane.
Yeah, as you said, split pushing choice against the Shen. Obviously, H2K looking to force team fights and get Shen out of that lane, but right now H2K doesn't have any hard engage. Ezreal doesn't offer anything, Zyra is not hard engaged, Kha'Zix can't really jump in head first. And against the Ryze, we see Talia often, Corki, Victor, Orianna. There's like a ton of picks that mid laners actually like to play against the Ryze.
Yeah.
But that's kind of a weird thing, because like nothing hard counters Ryze. But every mid laner has like two or three things where they're like, ooh, I really like to play this against the Ryze, but it doesn't counter it. Ryze will always do fine, he will always be able to lane, he will always scale into late game.
Well, we got the very, very exciting Victor Deficio.
Man, probably
slash
is...
S. Yes.
He's hit a new low right here. Well, he actually threatened to slap me in the casting room as well.
Safe, controlled. This is H2K. You mentioned there's no hard engage, but if there were a team that were averse to team fighting and wanted to win by playing, you know, smart, I think H2K would be one of the forerunners for that style of play.
Of course. I mean, it's always been the style that probably has kind of enforced on his teams. I will say though, I think this composition from H2K, while it is fantastic at like late game team fighting, I actually think it can be fairly difficult to play until you get to late game.
Yeah.
We talk about the lack of hard engage. If Trundle and Ryze gets off to a good start and they go to the side lanes and start pushing these side lanes very, very, very aggressively, H2K's way of like forcing something is either by sieging around the mid lane or by setting up like a Baron or Dragon. But if you don't have map control, if you don't have side lane pressure, that can actually be fairly hard to do. So I think H2K is going to rely a lot on Vitality playing aggressive and then H2K kind of responding and winning the late game team fights.
All right, responding to Vitality's aggression and side lane. That's what we're looking for. The drafts, they're on your screen. They're locked in. The champions are on the way to the Rift. It's time for game one between Vitality and H2K.
It's actually got slow.
It's slow. Void Assault. Look at that isolated damage.
Daisy, break up the fight. Combo Shark's healthy. Trashy does not live through it. And first blood secured.
First blood secured. Who will it be? Vitality or H2K? We're loading up onto the Rift. And if you look at the minimap, down in the bottom lane, there's already some shenanigans.
We don't want to see it, Trevor, because no one died. And here in the ULCS, we only show kills. No trading. Nuclear will have to go back, but luckily for him, it's early enough that he can return with the minions.
But Deficio, he had to start E.
That is...
lane pressure.
Yeah, that actually sucks. That definitely sucks for him. You want to have to queue for early push. But that's what happens when you get surprised. Level one, I think Vitality were kind of hiding the bush and then invaded towards where Nuclear was sitting in that river bush. And then he had to jump out. But again, this pick and ban phase from Vitality, they've been so special, I feel like. And not in the Unicorns of Love where we're super excited and it's kind of fancy way. It's more like, why are you first picking Varus when Jhin is available? Yes, I know H2K didn't pick it because they valued the Shen above it, but most teams would have been like, that's a weird trade. Yep. And now you give us Kha'Zix as well.
Yes, giving Yankos Kha'Zix, you know, the former First Blood King. Yes, I say former First Blood King because right now Joko is actually the jungler with the highest First Blood participation. Deficio, Joko is coming for the King.
He's definitely coming for the King. Better not miss. And that's what we got to see in this game here. Yankos was crying on Twitter because of his lack of first blots when I decided to tweet it out and taunt him a little bit. He's angry and he's ready.
He's ready indeed.
Also, Ivern first blots.
It's less likely, isn't it?
It is less likely in a sense. Obviously, what Ivern can do is you can do a full claim your own jungle, which is what Joko is doing now. So he set up these two camps. He's going to go towards his bottom side. He's going to grab Raptor. He's going to grab Red Buff. Then he's going to return to the top side to get Raptor, get the Wolf Camp, sorry, and the Grump. And then he gets level 4 before any jungler. And he can start ganking.
That's what he's going to look for. I mean, there's a lot of damage with Nuketuck and Cabo. And you saw the First Blood participation down on the bottom of your screen. Joker's actually been involved in all 5 of his team's First Bloods. And Yankos with an early hop over the wall.
That's interesting pathing here from Joko. He doesn't go top and take the entire wave. He recalls on bottom side. Also just to buy him a few seconds to potentially see a gank from Yankos. And then cancel his recall and go in and counter gank. Sad to his recall because he didn't see Yankers down here. Nuclear with that E level 1, which is huge, as you highlighted, Trevor. Getting bullied early on.
Have to see how many of these lost hits.
That's the worst feeling, by the way. If you guys play Zyra at home, be careful with just randomly E-ing the wave on the tower, because you might ruin some CS for your AD carry.
Oh yes, Nuclear 10
he lost
to
a few
18,
there.
Quite a few indeed. I think he was able to pick up the cannon creep at least, but that's me being super optimistic here.
Such a positive guy, Trevor.
Being shoved into lane, and this Zyra, you know, being good into Mel's, not going to get the chance because of how heavily Nuclear is being pushed in.
It's also your AD carry choice. Like, Ezreal, yes, he has good early, like, level 1, 2, and 3, but then he loses after to things like Varus, Ashe, these kind of picks. So, Vitality are actually happy with this 2v2 bot lane right now, just due to the AD carry choices. We know Victor in the mid lane against Ryze, he will farm, he will scale, he will wave clear. That's effectively what you're doing, so Ryze will have control to roam. Looking at your minimap, Nuke Dog is already moving just to place a ward. But he can keep doing that. Again and again, he can instant wave clear on this Ryze, threaten bot lane, threaten top lane, allows Vitality to play very fast here in the early game.
Talking about Febavin on this Victor, he's a jungler who's received a lot of pressure. Traditionally, opponents against H2K have tried to camp Febavin out, and he's on this control mage. He's going to be able to play either aggressive or defensive with that wave clear, depending on what he wants, and just wait for Yankos to support where needed.
Yeah, you're probably not going to gank the Victor with cleanse in this game, but if you are Vitality, you have to obviously respect the Shen ulti that's going to come in later. Oftentimes, you attack the global then, you go top, Trundle pushes in the Shen. Once he gets level 6 and he gets his first item completed, then you get the Ryze roam, you get invade with Iron. Both junglers are bottom side again.
Flash over the wall. Shani flashes away to safety. One for one. Joker was coming down and Yankos also hanging around in the river.
First time in 2 weeks I've seen a Shani actually survive a gank. Impressive change from him. Normally he would flash the other way.
Spicy this time round. Shani's gonna get rooted in place. Nuclear going very aggressive. The SMG
classic Shani.
First blood.
Man,
to
I love
Nuclear.
That man. I love him. I have no flash, I don't care. Let me just go 1v2 here. My AD carry sitting and farming. Good old Hachani. Everything is standard again.
So last week and the week before, six isolated deaths. We'll spend another moment. Yankos looking for Nuketuck, who's running low on mana. There is a flash for Nuketuck's Ryze. Yankos fires out the Void Spikes. Really wants to scare him away. But yeah, six times Hachani has died alone, where there are no teammates within 1500 range.
Yeah, so let's look at this replay. Yankos is still on the bottom side. He could actually turn around and come down and jump the Dragon Wall. Hachani is on a ward. His AD carry is still farming really far away from him. And he's like, I'm just going to take this random trade for absolute zero reason.
Definitely lost that one. Yankos is going to leap in. Cabochard, Pillar of Ice does nothing. H2 kills.
Sadly for Yankos, this was only second blood. Was not part of the first one.
No, it wasn't.
He's gonna be happy though. He gets the Karthik again, almost like a free pick granted to him.
Technically though, Joker is still ahead of Yankos.
Yeah, exactly.
In first blood participation. Those stats haven't changed yet, but H2K, very good early moves. Hachani donated a kill, and Yankos and Karthik making the champion work.
Ah, good guy Hachani, man. Coming to Europe, feeding all the bot lanes. And me and Krabble, we were watching the games last week. We were rewatching the games last week with Vitality and Hachani. And the most impressive thing was, even in moments when Vitality were like 4v2 or even 5v2, Hachani managed to kind of get split from the team and then get killed by like a 0-5 Karthik. It happened like multiple times. I have no idea how. There's clearly miscommunication between him and the other Vitality guys. Bottom is taking some damage here.
Yeah, no Daisy yet for Joker, so not really under threat. Nuketuck is going to get jumped on by a full rotation from Febavin. Just trying to push him out of lane. Nothing really gained just yet, and the wave is still pushing in Nuketuck, so he can respond. And as it stands, Cabo throws down the Subjugate onto Odawan there. There's still a flash. Keeps walloping in with that pillar. And now Odo, not really at risk of being dove just yet. Still difficult against the Shen.
It is. Yankos is mid again, Trevor. Nuketuck has both summoners, so this gank is going to be almost impossible to execute due to the fact that Victor CC is not consistent enough. Top lane though, Trundle. He's like this weird counterpick because he's such a slow counterpick. Like, it takes forever for Trundle to actually, like, really take over the lane and just to kind of weave you down.
Yeah.
It's more he forces you out of lane, out sustains you, and then starts hitting the turret, which is what Cabochard is looking to do.
It's about the lane, you know, and pressure, but it also needs support from Vision, and that's what I want to keep my eyes on that mini map for.
And then the other thing it offers, which is this combo we've seen before now in Europe, is the Malzahar Trundle combined. That means if you are playing a tank, which Ordo is in this case on Shen, you're just going to get wrecked in every team fight because you go in, Trundle ulties you, and then Malzahar ulties you, and there's like this percent damage, and the tanks die really quick.
So Fischio, that is the theory, okay? We need to see exactly how well Hachani and Cabochard make that work, because while the theory sounds excellent and beautiful,
it's very spicy,
there is still an element of positioning there that needs to be adhered to. Yeah. So I'll believe it when I see it, and I'm optimistic at the possibilities.
It's an option for them. Problem is, obviously, then behind the Shen you're killing, there's like three carry, four carries here with the Zyra, who might kill you.
Joker's going to be able to just get out of range of Che's Grasping Roots.
And if we're lucky, we see one of the biggest changes here in 7.2 in this game. The Rift Scuttler will eat your Honey Fruit. You have to kill the Rift Scuttler to get it away from the Honey Fruit so you can grab it. It can be impactful, probably not, but there's a chance you can't grab it and you die.
Everything's impactful, right?
Everything
I've seen butterfly effects. You know, one little butterfly flap can start a tornado on the other side of the planet. That's how it works.
Yeah,
right?
I don't really believe.
Okay.
What you're saying right now, Trev?
One honey fruit being eaten by the Rift Scuttler could feed Febvin in the mid lane and allow his Victor to go off.
See, that's what I want to see. Because then I know the live designers are sitting at home kind of clapping, being like, yeah, that's what we wanted. Bot lane gang.
Wow, there's the flash engage. Che's in trouble. Stand United, though, keeping him alive just long enough to flash away. It's H2K that kill Hachani. Now Yankos. Void assaults forward. Very big shield coming up from Joko onto Steelback. And that was an instantaneous ulti from Odo.
Really good reaction from H2K. Vitality without teleport, going for a gank in the bottom lane. No deep vision to spot Yankos either. So it was a very risky play and it backfired. Kamushab might get this tower down. 50%. Shen is coming back. This wave is dying. Odo might be able to return in time.
Gonna be close. It looked like Joker was stood on top of a ward. So H2K aware of the impending doom. They get their third kill. A double kill for Ezreal at 10 minutes. That's a pretty good start, if ever I've seen one.
Especially because he had to start with Arcane Shift in the lane, and he lost a lot of CS. So the fact he can now bounce back in this game is important. Ezreal is one of these champions where you need like two or three items to... So especially two items, and the third is good for you as well. But it becomes super impactful. This turret, though, is still taking damage. So is top lane tower. So Vitality are looking at these juicy, juicy outer turrets. But they've been giving up three kills already.
A lot of kills indeed. Teleport's going to be up for Odo 1-8 very, very soon. True Shot Barrage just to clear out the wave here as Joko using that Brush Maker. Decent route, but no minions to work with. And that means Vitality, their siege is being delayed.
Still, we're early in the game.
Yeah.
It's okay if you're Vitality when it comes to taking down this tower. TP can be matched by Kabo now, so that means Odo 1-8 can't really just TP down bot lane and make something happen super easy. Ryze can still roam mid first, also has the ulti, so Vitality will get this tower.
Yeah.
And that really is the game plan, like, take this bottom lane tower, then take top lane tower.
Nucleus trying to play a bait as Yankos is waiting in the wing, stood right on top of a ward, though.
Is Vitality that a control ward next to it?
Fully aware.
Interesting. So basically, in the tri-bush, the control ward placed by H2K does actually not block the vision ward, because there's a little tree sticking out, just blocking the vision of the control ward. And Yankos obviously expects there not to be any wards because he has his control ward down. He was spotted, though.
Unfortunate for Yankos and H2K. As it stands, though, we keep an eye on Nuketech and Febivin. And Deficio, while Vitality look like they're going to get this tower first blood, let's touch very briefly on Nuketech versus Febivin. Nuketech looked pretty good last week. Febivin obviously playing very well throughout the spring split. And these are two majors that are going to continue to scale into the mid game, continue to scale into the late game, and of course it's Febivin that is, you know, looking very good as far as the stats are concerned.
Yeah, we get to see a dragon fight here, Trevor.
Well, dragon fight indeed. Yankos going to get taken down by this Infernal Drake. Not yet. Strangle thorns from Che, and Yankos survives. How does Hachani always do it?
So Nuketech has not skilled his ulti yet. He's putting all his focus on just the laning phase, so he couldn't even join and actually finish Yankos. But just seeing the replay, if it was possible for Nuke Duck to port in with ulti and actually turn it around, or if there were too many members from H2K and it was just Tachani on a solo mission, again, he was so close. Like, come on, there's like one hit more from the dragon.
Do you know, I really, in prep for this series, guys, I actually said to DeFisher, I really don't want to focus on Tachani dying.
He's making it really hard
not to
focus on
it. Last week, you know, and like, when he comes over from LCK, there was the whole meme about it, and he got better. And I really said I don't want to do because the story's overdone. Come on, dude, you're not making it easy on us. 0-3. Handing gold on a silver platter to H2K. But because of Tower First Blood, it's Vitality that are still even
yeah,
in the game.
See, Trevor, he won his lane. Scoreboard doesn't always tell the story. Pressure the lane. Okay, his jungler was there, like half the time. I think if we get the jungle proximity around bot lane from Joko, it's very, very high compared to Jankos. But still, Tachani fed away some kills. Could definitely avoid two of them, 100%.
Yeah. At least two of three. We're getting to 15 minutes. Taking a look down the CS, it's pretty much even across the board. Obviously, the two kills for Nuclear, despite giving up Tau first blood, means it's close. All right, Tachani, Nethergrass. No Nethergrass. A few seconds longer. There comes Daisy. Jankos being burned down with Malefic Visions, and there's nothing to follow up. No ulti from Tachani, and
that means
they just back away.
So H2K swapped to top side. Obviously, a very early swap from them, which is very good here, seeing as you have no bot lane tower to play around, and if a Ryze can push out mid and go down and kill you. All right, so let's see this again. There's no ulti from Nuke Dog. So you can't really get past the Victor. But in this situation, had Nuke Dog actually skilled ulti, I think he could have TP'd or ultied in there and joined the fight. We're still by coming around. Joko!
All right, Nethergrass from Tachani, this time saving Joko's life for a few seconds longer. Daisy Stampede indeed. And Joko manages to escape with his life. Tachani, right place, right time this time around.
This time he didn't die, but he did use his flash. He's probably gonna die within the next 3 minutes. And H2K, once again, I think actually they respond really well. Like, we said this in Champ Select, H2K is calm, he's not looking to be like overly aggressive in the lane phase. Later on in the game, they can't like hard force a team fight either. So they're reacting to Vitality all the time. Joko, Tachani was in the river, fighting for vision, they got punished, two flashes down. Only Che has flashing cooldown on H2K's side, and now it's a good roam here from Febby, will be spotted though.
Yeah, taking a look at that item build. Got that hex core already at perfect state. Pair of Lucy boots up, and while H2K applied pressure on the top left quadrant of the map, there's a blue buff steal from Nuke Duck in the bottom right.
I'm very surprised that H2K has just been able to swap top lane and not really be under pressure until now. But obviously it comes down to Joko and Tachani having to flash just before. Because Vitality are trying to like push two lanes now. They surrender Kabushard's lane against the duo of H2K. And say, we're going to push in bot with Ryze, we're going to push in mid with Varus. And they need to just keep sieging and getting damage on these turrets here. Because when you play 1-3-1, you want open map.
Yeah.
When you play against Victor, you want a really open map so you can play away from his lane. Because you're never going to properly get to his turret with his instant wave clears. You always want to play around him, and then you want to threaten these like flanks on him.
Well, you talked a lot about the lanes and how, you know, Cabochard's going to be unlocking these side lanes for Vitality. Do you know this is the first game all spring that H2K have not secured the first tower? They had first tower secured every single game. Despite Tachani's deaths, the pressure in the champion composition has given them now what looks like their second tower. There's no contest from H2K. They're at least going to take a marginal lead. And look, there's even pressure middle. So Vitality playing the pressure game fairly well.
They definitely are with their winning lanes, winning side lanes, should say steal back.
Oh my word, the Chaos Storm in Jankos. Stand United delivers Oda Wamne to the front line. Nuketak's over on the side. Tachani takes a ride out, gets a silence and a Nethergrass. Joko still tanking for days. He's already used Redemption. That's the big shield from the trigger seat. Realm Warp forward and H2K running away. Vitality have got one kill. Nuketak now gets the shield from Joko. And I didn't see if the teleport was cancelled by Cabo. Odo not looking for a target just yet. And Odo still with teleport available. It ends up being a 1-for-1.
It's a 1-for-1, but H2K again is trying to push on top side. They want to really get this tower down because they want to get some gold in the bank. They've been doing fine in terms of kills. Now they even out the gold here as well. They got the Infernal Drake, so while Vitality have used the side lane pressure to get two outer turrets, they're still on the clock here. They're still
Nuketuck wants this. Got red buff. Rune Prison, overload. The second one doesn't connect, and Nuketuck ghosted up for that.
Small thing to highlight there. Febby delays his cleanse, because he wants to see where Nuketuck is shooting the Q first. Then he cleanses and steps to the side. Because if he cleanses instantly, Nuketuck can still hit him with the Q here and actually deal a lot of damage to him. Still back, Hat Flash, didn't get to use it. Kha'Zix, that was left over, given to Yankers. Picking up a basic kill. Good ult here from Achani into Nuketuck combo, and then also good ult from Nuketuck after to kind of follow and go even in the trade.
Whenever I see picks and bans to Fisher, I always look at what was the first priority picks for both teams and how are they performing. Vitality picked that Varus first blue side. Did well, at least. Helped control the lane despite Achani. And they allowed Yankos, they allowed Yankos to play Kha'Zix, who's 2-1-1. Now I want to see what Yankos does with this versus how much pressure Steelback can continue to apply.
Yeah, and then also the Shen pick was left over to H2K. This has been one of the most valuable top laners in Europe. And even here on 7.2, where you can go grasp something on dying, Shen is very strong. Not one of the tanks you rely on Cursed of the Colossus to be good.
All right, H2K. Looking for the dragon as Odo.
That's the combo.
Yeah, Odo sacrifices his life for this one. Well, sacrifice is a strong word. Odo is the victim for the dragon. This is an investment into future, into late game for H2K. We're going up to 20 minutes, and with Daisy, this should be a tower. Cabochard is wrecking this tower. This is a scary sign if H2K cannot maintain control over Cabochard. Oh, cheers. Nuketuck Ram warps out. Flash for flash. Che gets that from Nuketuck.
Yeah, I mean, H2K right now, they're taking Trace. They don't want to take. I'm going to face Trick there and die. This tower's going to die as well. Like, Vitality are just kind of left to do whatever they want.
H2K feel like they've got their pants around their ankles. They're being dragged around the map, and Vitality, 5-1. This is not the early game we were expecting.
Well, again, we talked about the scaling on H2K and champs like Victor, Ezreal. We talked about how the comp can be hard to play as well, but that was also more looked at later on in the game. Vitality, we knew they're going to win topside. Bot lane, because of Arcane Shift from Ezreal as well, was pretty easily won by Vitality, and also with Joko's help. Yes, they gave away kills, but they still managed to take down that early turret. So Vitality have been doing their job so far with winning these lanes, applying pressure to the side lanes, and they need to keep doing that. Like, Kha'Zix needs to just find that side lane every single time. Bot lane should be the one he's going to now because one, Baron is up and he has teleport, and two, that's an out of turret he can kill.
Oh, a lot of damage onto Hachani, but he's able to get away with his life. And Deficio, the comp from H2K is going to continue to scale and develop. But when we've seen H2K at the weakest is when they're looking at some of those bigger team fights, so other elements of the game are stronger. How do you think their team fighting composition is going to come up against? It's quite an interesting comp here from Vitality that ideally wants to 4-1.
Yeah, it's not like Vitality's composition is terrible at team fighting, but the Trundle impact can be difficult to use in these fights here. Often you like ult the tank and you kind of just sit in the front line and be super annoying. It's hard for you to stick to targets, especially something like Ezreal. But I still think with Ryze in there, with Varus, a well-played team fight from Vitality will be good.
Yeah.
I think H2K's team fighting comp, though, is overall stronger just because of Victor Ezreal.
Right. So the champion combination puts it slightly in favor of H2K. We need to see if the player combination makes it work too.
It's basically like what I like about H2K is the kiting.
Yeah.
I like how hard it is to get close to a Victor with his gravity field. I like with Zyra ulti, Ezreal, his personal mobility. It makes it hard for like Trundle and Ryze to stick to these targets here and like just kill them very easily. But if Vitality can flank and get to like Febivan very early, they can definitely take him down quickly and win the fight.
Which Vitality will we see? Last week in the 2-0 against Origin, the first game was very clean. They snowballed extremely effectively, and Vitality closed out game one in magnificent fashion. Game two, a slightly different story. A little messier, a little more mistakes. And Vitality won't be allowed that freedom for mistakes, not only because the caliber of opponent is stronger, but also their team composition. Decent route there onto Yankos, but there's no follow-up from Vitality.
But here's what's going to happen, Trev. Kha'Zix will just keep sitting in that side lane, and if H2K are not able to force a fight around Baron or Dragon, which they won't be able to if they're getting pushed back on the map all the time, then Kha'Zix alone will take another turret, possibly an inhib, and there's nothing Shen can do against him. And that will just allow Vitality to play this game with all by pushing mid, and then letting Kabusha split push. Because if you push mid first, H2K never gets to set up Baron and never gets to force a Baron fight. And then you join Kabusha like this and you pressure this tower here. H2K always a step behind in reacting because they have no lane pressure in any lane.
That just means Vitality take the sixth tower of the game. Vitality now peel away. They maintain their gold lead. They've got pressure lead on multiple lanes.
And they don't care if H2K's composition is built to late game team fight. They just care about the fact they're winning with Ryze and Trundle, and Varus can instant push mid, and Ezreal cannot. Yeah. Ezreal needs time. He sits there, mystic shots, kind of hits with that little whimsy auto attack he has. It takes him forever. Varus is one arrow and then like a few autos and it's gone. So Vitality doesn't even care about H2K's composition. They're playing their own game. They're only playing for structures right now.
Yeah. Well, that's good because the structures that win you games.
It is.
Deficio, this is a little bit of growth, a good development from Vitality. Two items for Steelback. He's got that Edge of Night to complement the Ghost Blade. Two items for really everybody on Vitality, except the Chani for now. Slowly scaling up on the H2K side as well. Jankos went for that QSS. Second item. Get rid of some of that CC. Especially because he wants to be jumping on Hachani as many times as possible. Extremely important.
Yeah, definitely important. Edge of Night, item I like a lot right now. Lethality, obviously. But
some
also,
buffs.
We decided to buff it. Gave it 15 seconds less cooldown on the active, and it's a fairly strong active to use if you time it correctly. Think of like Jankos jumping in and his first Q gets blocked or Shen Tong gets blocked. Like, that can be extremely impactful in a potential fight.
So much damage protected. It's 30 seconds till the next dragon. H2K, not the greatest vision, but setting up for it, it feels like.
It's just very hard to get down wards when you can't push lanes.
Yeah.
Because that means it's often one or two guys kind of moving in on their own, and the chance of you then getting caught is very, very high.
I mean, talking about getting caught, like, Nuclear and Shea getting caught at that level one and starting E and then being pressured the whole time, that small little impact has had such a big snowball effect on the entire game. Vitality played very well with Kabushka. They played very well with Steelback's Varus. But Vitality, are they really starting Baron here instead of Dragon? Okay. They know there's no smites.
They're trying to rush it down with Daisy because Jankos was spotted down near the Dragon.
There goes Daisy. Chain of Corruption is going to start to spread. Odo's on the front line, locked down. But it's Che that gets caught with Nethergrass. Che's able to flash away. Stranglethorns is going to buy some time. Daisy still alive. Redemption buys a couple seconds. And Nuclear with the Mystic Shot gets the kill. Stand United on Jankos' back. Jankos flashes over the wall, leaves Soto Omne behind. Round Warp still available for Nuketak, gonna get needed. Steelback snipes one down. Piercing arrow across H2K's broadside. Steelback still alive. The shield survives for a few seconds longer. This is a fight on a million fronts. Nuketak with a double on the back end. 3 for 3.
Let's see. Nuclear Order Amner. There's an ulti from Ryze. It's a bait, though.
It is a bait. Nuclear trying to at least clear this wave. He's got a Vamp Scepter for HP. Disappointed Prolly. In the bottom of your screen, Odo and Nuclear. They're looking for Nuke Duck. No, they turn. It's Choke on the target. Mystic Shot, Rune Prison, Nuclear, Arcane Shift, but the shield explodes. Nuke Duck and Choco ace H2K.
So in the end, Vitality win the fight because of Nuke Duck. But damn, that was a tough start because Hachani ulted Che instead of that Shen. We talked about the combo, Trevor. They could have killed Odo Amner so easily. Baron will go down, though, and it doesn't matter because this is the year of Nuke Duck. I had to say it, Trevor, just for the fun. Come on, he's playing well.
Exceptional performance. Nuke Duck and Vitality have Baron at 27 minutes. They won the team fight. And now Steelback's
still
for a steal. Is this going to steal?
Do it.
Close. Jankos able to steal the third dragon, but what a great fight! And exactly like you said, Deficio, Nuke Duck cleaning up on the back end.
I really want to see it again, because I think the start here from Vitality could have been much cleaner. So, ulti is great for Steelback, and now if you just ulti Odo Amner as the Malzahar, you kill him very easily, and this fight is much, much simpler to play. We see the kiting, we talked about this in Champs League from H2K, they want, you know, Vitality engaging in, you kite back, you set down some of your CC, Nuclear, you can steal a lot of damage. It's very hard to get onto them, but now H2K also chase. chase too far because NukeDuck is on top side. He's kind of ignored. All the carries are just running towards the rest of Vitality, and NukeDuck kind of sitting on his own, flashing in. And at this point, as Arise, if you get to clean up this
so much backline, damage.
Oh man, that was some sick ass damage.
Through exhaust in a 1-on-2.
Oh, H2K are gonna be so annoyed at themselves when they rewatch this fight, how they just ignore NukeDuck on the top side and they just chase and chase and chase.
I probably was watching that entire fight.
That's why he was mad.
Yeah, exactly. I understand even more clearly that NukeDuck was allowed to run free. Vitality applying pressure on two lanes. Remember, there's no inhibitor turret up top. There's now pressure being applied middle and bottom lane. Jankos at risk of getting caught out. Sidesteps the root caller very luckily, and Vitality slowly but surely chipping away at these objectives, DeFizio.
Yeah, really, that was the fight for H2K to get a goal lead and get back in this game, and they're really far behind now. Yes, they have three dragons, but at the moment, the goal lead is the more important thing. Vitality, 7 towers to 2. Kaposhard, while he's 0-2, can still have impact in a side lane. Ryze is the Fed member.
DeFizio, can you explain to me how backstage we were talking about the matchups today and talking about how, you know, H2K should be favored to go 2-0. H2K should be able to punish Vitality, and yet they're 8,000 gold down.
League of Legends is a weird thing. European League of Legends is always very hard to predict. I think based on what we've seen the first 2 weeks, H2K should be a much stronger team than Vitality in current form. However, each week can change a lot. We're early, people are still learning a lot of stuff, so
yeah.
If you had a great week with some really good scrims, maybe you come in as a completely new team. They did take down Origin 2-0. Second game, yes, was a bit of a mess. But Vitality clearly had a plan with the draft. While we can question the first pick,
yeah,
the winning side lanes have allowed Vitality to get a big lead in this game.
Absolutely. Vitality now, side lane pressure for NukeDuck. He's got that Ghost and Realm Warp if he needs to join a fight. Che is taking a lot of damage from those piercing arrows, as does Jankos. Look at that. The rest of Vitality now working with the minion liners. Another piercing arrow. This was a first pick Varus. Duskblade of Drakthar, Ghostblade, Edge of Night. And the inhibitor turret in the mid lane is just... it's melting like a hot knife through butter. That quickly. H2K, where do they find their fight? There's no hard engage.
They can't hard engage.
You said this in picks and bans.
They cannot hard engage. They can literally stand here and wait for Vitality to engage on them.
Okay.
But Vitality, as we said, are playing for structures.
Yes, they are. They're ignoring the champions. They're still behind in kills.
They don't care. I'm like, oh, is that, you know, a Shen and a Kha'Zix in front of me? I'm just going to step back. Then the rest of my team are going to hit the inhib. We don't care about Ezreal, we don't care about Victor, we're never gonna let them fight. Jankos is trying now.
He is indeed gonna deliver Odo Wamne. It's a decent taunt, but it's not enough yet. Odo,
this
time gets locked down. Hachani's figured it out. It's NukeDuck that's unstoppable. His fifth kill of the game. Inhibitor in the mid lane is destroyed, and H2K are running with their tails between their legs.
Vitality getting everything at the moment. Two inhibs going down. 10,000 gold lead. And H2K can have all the damage they want from the backline. The backline can never get to deal the damage.
No, it cannot. There's no tower to worry about in the top lane. H2K, 25 seconds in a 4-on-5. The inhibitor being chunked down. Steelback's running out of mana. They've got to be careful in the gigantic shield on NukeDuck from that Seraph.
Bjergsen? Oh, okay.
Nah, I thought it was far enough. Blade. Baron wasn't even up.
No, but still. Yeah. Whenever I see Arise do that now on top side,
Is that what you're calling it?
I have to call the Bjergsen now.
Okay, I can go with that.
We don't have a choice.
I mean, it was a team play, so would you not?
Yeah, but if you heard the mic check, it was his call.
It was.
So yes, the team stepped into it.
Yeah.
So congratulations, okay. You click on the...
Hey, he provided instructions, bottom left corner, and everyone stepped in the bottom left corner.
That's very
which
true.
Which made me funny, because the circle doesn't have a corner.
Not bad.
Meta, DeFizio.
You're very smart.
Vitality have got 3 inhibitors down, a 9,000 gold lead in H2K. Their mind has to be on game 2 picks and bans. H2K have side selection. Picks and bans, though, may have been an element of why they lost, you know, not being able to control early game. But it was in-game decisions where Vitality earned their lead.
Yeah, I mean, I think it was a mix. I think H2K's comp, as we talked about champs, like, is very hard to play.
Yeah.
Because, again, it's so slow scaling. It's so passive in what you do. So the way you beat like these comps with Victor, Orianna, Corki, is again, you play side lanes, you play split push. So you don't give them the 5-on-5 team fight where you just like run at them. And that's what Vitality been doing, because they drafted a Trundle as a counterpick to Shen. The Ryze had control in mid and has been able to control side lanes. Nukedog again has been playing well. So it's really a smart answer from Vitality. Maybe it was all a bait with the first big virus.
So Fisher, is it fair to say Vitality have won this game soon based on macro play? Is it decision made? Yes, team comps are a side of it, right? But understanding the weaknesses of H2K's team comp is what's allowed Vitality to start on the Nexus.
According to that, definitely fair. Vitality, I think, actually would feel like it's been a fairly easy game to play.
Yes, looks like it. It's a good taunt into Nukedog, but he's able to escape with his life. So much damage in Odo 1. Nethergrass onto Febiven. Febiven gets dropped down before he can even use the Chaos Storm. Odo 1 is killed as well. Super minions, the army is flooding into H2K's base. The Nexus is now the target. Nuclear gets knocked aside by the Pillar of Ice. And it simply does not matter. Hachani will die as Vitality pick up game one against H2K.
Well played, Vitality. Some curveballs in the draft, for sure.